All right. Hello, everyone. Welcome to another International Accounting Standard I-16 Property, Plant and Equipment, shortly abbreviated as PPE. So today we're just going to take a brief look at this standard called Property, Plant and Equipment. We'll see how property items categorized in the property, plant and equipment are treated in the financial statements. Usually there'll be treated as non-current assets, and as you know, actually most non-current assets are depreciated. So we'll look at ways of depreciating the assets, just like in your previous studies, I hope. But also a lot more. Actually, when speaking of standards, you encounter things like recognition, you'll encounter things like measurement, presentation, classification, and disclosure, things like that. So to start with, this is our standard called A16, PPE, property, plant, and equipment. So what is PPE? Because, you know, we are now in the practical aspect. It's not like just the mechanics of accounting, like accruals, prepayments, bank reconciliation, correction of errors. No, it's not like that. Right now, we are just going to try to look at line by line of the financial statements. For example, line by line of the non-current assets, like property, plant and equipment and other items. So right now, we are first trying to look at this line item called PPE, property, plant and equipment. What is it? And what do you do when you encounter it? How do you account for it in the financial statements? So that's what we're going to try to do. And so what is PPE now? Property, plant, and equipment. These are tangible assets. So first of all, you should note this. These are tangible assets. You know, you can have assets that are tangible, but also those that are intangible. So any asset that is not tangible actually is obviously not part of property, plant, and equipment. And so you cannot use the rules of the property, plant, and equipment to deal with an asset that is not tangible. I think at this point, you know, some examples of assets that are not tangible. For example, goodwill, those are intangible assets. Maybe computer software, you cannot touch a software, computer software. So it's also intangible. And right now here, we are just speaking of tangible assets. Those intangible assets actually have their own standards, but actually you also encounter intangible assets that are monetary. Intangible assets that are monetary have also their own standards, as you'll see. So property, plant, and equipment are tangible assets that are held for use in the production or supply of goods or services. This is number one. For rental to others, number two, or for administrative purposes. First of all, you should note this thing. But also we are told that they are expected to be used during more than one period. Being expected to be used for more than one period only goes to show that they are non-current. So in other words, this definition could have been this way, that property, plant, and equipment are tangible non-current assets. So if you just placed with the word non-current here between tangible and assets, there would be no need actually to use this sentence down here. This AI expected to be used for more than one period. There will totally be no need to use it here. So this is property, plant, and equipment. You can hold it for use in the for production. Let's say you as a company, you're a manufacturing company. Actually, you have a machine and you are using that machine to produce actually your products. That machine actually is a PPE. It's a property, it falls under property, plant, and equipment. Actually, it's a machine, so it could be under equipment, but actually it falls under PPE, meaning that it falls under IAS 16. But also, not necessarily, actually the non-current asset should not necessarily be used for production. It could be used for supply of goods or services. Let's say you are the company, you have a car, and that's the sole purpose of that car is just to transport goods to customers. At which point the company incurs carriage outward costs, carriage outward expenses, and something like that. So that's what I was just trying to speak of, right?
Yeah,
that's what I was just trying to speak of. So you can have a non-current asset, not used for production, but can be used to supply goods or services. But also, it can be held for rental to others. You can be holding an asset and it's just renting to others. Actually, we'll speak well about this because actually there is one standard called IAS 40. It's investment property. Now, if you look at that, there is a word property, but also here in IAS 16, there is a word property. So what if something is a property? How would you classify it whether as to whether it belongs to IAS 16 or IAS 40? How would you go up with that? How would you go up with that to ascertain or on whether it belongs where? That's another point. So it can be holding it for rental purpose. Actually, as we go further, we'll learn more about this. There are properties that are you for rental purpose, but this property can be an IAS 40 investment properties. So another reason here, another use, it could be used for administrative purpose. So actually, let me tell you one thing. If you're using something for production, supply of goods or services, or for administrative purpose, it's obvious that you can be using it and that it can generate cash flows in conjunction with other activities, not on itself, something like that. So this is PPE or property, plant and equipment. And now we go to another section here. This is the scope. We go to the scope here. What the scope? When going to the scope now, we just need to know the limits under which I-16 applies. We have to know about this. So we are told here that I-16 should be followed when accounting for property, plant, and equipment unless another international accounting standard requires a different treatment. So in case we encounter something that another accounting standard requires an alternative treatment, you have to use that other standard. So I-16 does not apply to the following. Actually, these are just examples, but most of them may not be at your level. It depends on the level you are. For example, if you are doing strategic business reporting for HCA, all these exceptions, they apply. So I-16 does not apply to the following. A, biological assets related to agricultural activity, apart from bearer biological assets. Actually, when speaking of agriculture as itself, as a standard, this is dealt with under IAS 41. That's agriculture, IAS 41. But actually, there might be plants, there might be a plant that bear other plants and that they can be accounted for is under PPE. But actually, this is no concern to you right now. So it's just an example, you can just leave it. Also, B, I-16 does not apply to mineral rights and the mineral reserves such as oil, gas, and other non-regenerative resources. Does not apply, but also does not apply to PPE classified as held for sale. You might have an asset, you might have a non-current asset initially classified as PPE, but actually, when it meets the classification as being held for sale as per IFRS 5, that asset will no longer be treated as per IS-16 PPE because if it is treated as held for sale, that means that you expect to sell it actually in 12 months, within the next 12 months, and so that asset becomes a current asset, not a non-current asset. And so you do not have to apply the principles of IS-16. So I thought, yeah, that, however, the standard applies to property, plant, and equipment used to develop these assets. So in case maybe you are using property, plant, and equipment to develop these assets, actually can apply them, no problem. All right, these are bearer biological assets. We are just at the very beginning. We are at the very, very beginning of I-16, so you can just play a bit. Bearer biological assets. This is actually, when speaking of biological assets and agricultural activity, actually we explained it in under IAS 41, but we just need to speak of bearer biological assets. Biological assets that bear what we are just going to see it now. Bearer biological assets, especially plantation trees, such as grapevines or rubber trees and oil palms are within the scope of I-16. So there are trees that can be accounted for as per I-16, but their end products, their products are treated for as per IAS 41 agriculture. That is not our concern here. So we have just been given an example here of grapevines, of rubber trees, something like that. But also told that This applies to the plants which are solely used to grow produce over several periods and are not themselves consumed. The plants themselves are not consumed. They are just used to grow produce. For example, grapevines, actually, they are grapes, rubber trees, they bear rubber, and oil palms, things like that. So this is what we're just talking about. So they are not themselves consumed, being usually scrapped when no longer productive. You have a tree, it's producing something, producing fruits. Let's say at the end of the day, when the tree is old, it's just scrapped. Actually, it is sold at almost no value, something like that. And so we are told here that they are measured at accumulated cost until maturity, and then become subject to depreciation and impairment charges. Now, have a break. Take a little break and listen to me very carefully here. What has been spoken of here is what actually we are just going to speak of, IAS 16 PPE. Something like depreciation, impairment. Actually, this is what we are just going to speak of in the next sections. So first of all they are trying to speak of biological assets here is what? For, let's say you today, you have gone somewhere, you have bought a machine for using it in production. If you have bought a machine for using it in production, you have incurred a certain cost. But what if you have just bought a little tree, or you have just planted a grapevine, and you will just be irrigating it, fertilizing, using fertilizers, actually all kinds, all sorts of maintenance, but it is yet to produce. That means that you will have to accumulate. That's why you are saying they are measured at accumulated cost until maturity. That means we'll count all the costs of that tree until the tree is ready to start giving the grapevines. I mean, to start giving the grapes, let's say, suppose we are dealing with the grapevine, and then become subject to depreciation and impairment charges. So when, say, the grapevine is ready to produce grapes, you can just do that cost and then presume that at the number of years, it can produce those grapes and then depreciate it accordingly. But about the issues of depreciation and all, we're just going to see it in our next section. So let's just be patient. So we're just going here to other definitions. Other definitions, what are we going to speak of other definitions here? What is cost actually? I've spoken of the word cost, but I think it's not something unusual that would be a complication to you. When just speaking of cost, we say that just the amount of cash or cash equivalents paid or fair value of other consideration given to acquire an asset at the time of its acquisition or construction. Let's say at the time of just acquiring an asset, there are several ways of acquiring an asset. You might pay. If you pay, that will be the cash equivalent pay. But also, by acquiring an asset, you may exchange with someone. As you'll see here, when you exchange an asset and that its fair value can be obtained, you can use its fair value. So that's why you are saying all the fair value of other consideration, something like that. But also you can acquire an asset, actually you can have an asset by constructing. You generate it by yourself. You start constructing it and then you complete. So you just actually count all the costs that were involved and they have to be capitalized and then you form your own cost. So this is just the definition of cost. But I doubt you'll be asked something like this in an exam. Then let's go to residual value. Any asset that you as a company are consuming, let's say you can have an asset that you expect to use it over 10 years, at the end of which you can scrap it for, let's say, a certain amount of money. Let's say it has cost you $8,000, and then you estimate that you can use it for 10 years, at the end of which you can scrap it for $500. Something like that. That's the residual value. That's the value of an asset that is retained after a certain period of time. So this is the residual value. That's why you're saying that the net amount which the entity expects to obtain for an asset at the end of its useful life, after deducting the expected cost of disposal. So this is what we call the residual value. what you expect. Maybe after selling an asset, you just you have your asset, you sell it. Actually, on the way of selling, you incur some expenses, and then what you remain with are the residual value. So we have things like that, and now we also have something here, entity-specific value. What is the entity-specific value? Entity-specific value is the value which an entity can judge on an asset depending on the use they intend to put on that asset. Let's say you as a company, let's say you have a car, or let's say you have a machine. You expect that machine to generate cash flows to you, let's say of $10,000 each year for 5 years. So to obtain the entity specific value, you just take those values from at the end of year one, year two, year three, let's say up to year five, and then you have to discount them with the concept of time value of money. You discount that amount, and the value obtained, that is the entity specific value. That is, it might be different to the market, but it might be relevant to you because you are the one who knows actually the use you are going to put to that asset, and you are almost certain of the cash flows that are expected to be generated from that asset. So here we are told, the entity-specific value is a present value of the cash flows an entity expects to arise from continuing use of an asset and for its disposal at the end of its useful life, or expects to incur when settling a liability. But actually, our main point here is this one up to this, because we are speaking of an asset here, not a liability. Just put it properly, but I think we are just going to see everything about this when speaking of impairment losses. So no need for calculation right now. All right, let's go to the definition of fair value. What is fair value? Fair value is the price that would be received to sell an asset or pay to transfer a liability in an orderly transaction to market participants at the measurement date. This is what we call fair value. Why? When speaking of fair value, it's usually logical and sensible to make reference to the market. So when speaking of fair value, let's say I have a machine and you ask yourself, oh, this is a machine. What is its value? It's a machine. It's mine. Let's say it's my own machine. Let's say it's your own machine. If it's your own machine, we'll ask ourselves, what value could you fetch from the market if you decide to sell that machine? That's why we say it's the price that would be received to sell an asset, if you have an asset. What if it's a liability? If it's a liability, it's the amount that will be paid to transfer a liability, not to settle a liability. Distinguish the terms here. We are speaking of to transfer a liability. You are the one owing, you make another person owing. That means that's the meaning of fair value. But what? There is another important point here. In an orderly transaction, what is an orderly transaction? An orderly transaction is a transaction actually which takes place, let me give you this example. When speaking of an orderly transaction, actually commercial substance should be considered. For example, it's not like someone is selling an asset that is worth $8,000, but just because of financial difficulties, he's selling for $1,000. That's not fair value, even if it's on the market. That's why we're speaking of the orderly transaction. It's not like someone is doing something just because of problems. But also we are told between market participants. By speaking of market participants, we mean that we are speaking of someone who has complete information about the market. So they are making informed decisions. It's not like just someone is just selling. No, you are making informed decisions. But also there's another point here. We are told at the measurement date. Why are they speaking of the measurement date? You know, fair value could be very, very volatile. Fair value could be changing. Today, an asset could have a fair value of $1,000, but come the two days later, it could have a fair value of $1,500. That's why you're speaking of the measurement date. Fair value ought to change at any point in time, depending on its volatility. So that's fair value. But also you have carrying amount. What is carrying amount? Actually, by the word itself, carrying amount. Carrying amount is just the amount at which an asset is carried in the financial statements. You take the financial statements, you go to PPE, you find that there is a single line shown as a certain figure. That's the carrying amount. So we are told here that carrying amount is the amount at which an asset is recognized in the statement of financial position after deducting any accumulated depreciation and accumulated impairment losses. We'll see about depreciation, we'll see about impairment losses. But just to give you a little, just to give you a very, very little concept, what is the difference between depreciation and impairment? You should actually be conversant with this. When speaking of in some courses like tax, actually, they are usually taken to be almost the same thing, but they are very different. When speaking of depreciation, what do we mean? Today, you could buy two cars or two machines of exactly the same, two exact machines. But as long as they are both ready, even if one is used and one is not used, they are just both depreciated. So it doesn't matter whether the machine, as long as the machine is ready for use, as long as an asset is ready for use, you start charging it depreciation. I hope you understand. But impairment loss is obvious. Impairment loss shows a picture about the fall in value of the asset. Either its fair value has just dropped dramatically, or maybe the continued use has just deteriorating the asset, so the asset's capacity is just decreasing. So normally we just expect that if you have two assets, one that is used and one that is not used, the one that is used will undergo impairment, but both will undergo depreciation, the same depreciation. So we have things like that. That's the difference between impairment and depreciation. All right, now let's just pass through the definitions. They are very important before we just come further for other explanations. So impairment laws, as I was just speaking, actually this has its own standard, IAS 36, have their own standard. Impairment laws is the amount by which the carrying amount of an asset exceeds its recoverable amount. It is impairment laws. What do we mean by this? You'll find it later actually under IAS 36 impairment. But what we mean is that we as a company, we should not allow to carry an asset in the financial statements at a value. Welcome, another. Welcome, Yabola, welcome. We should not allow to carry the asset in the books at a figure that is much, much more than its true value. So let me show you one example here. It's very nice, you know, when studying IAS 16, it takes time because you have to grasp the concepts of other standards. And if you do that in the future, it will become much, much easier for you. So what I'm just speaking of, when speaking of impairment loss, I just said impairment. Impairment loss, something like this. Let's say in the book, you have a PPE with a value of 20 million. But now, at the end of the year, you just go and check and find out that you recorded the PPE at 20 million, but actually you could only recoup 12 million from that PPE. You can obtain only 12 million from 20 million. That means that it is very wrong to record an asset at a value of 20 million while we are very well sure that we can only obtain 12 million from this asset, either by selling it or through continued use. So at this point, we say that we have an impairment loss of 8 million, and so we reduce this asset from 20 million to 12 million through a double entry. Things like that, this is an impairment loss. Actually, there is a standard I-36 impairment loss, and we'll see very, very clearly. So this should not be something of a concern, right? Right now, we can proceed here. So depreciation, what is depreciation? As I've told you earlier, depreciation and the impairment loss are two very different and distinct things. Depreciation is charged as long as an asset is ready for use, regardless of whether it is being used or not. But impairment loss ought to arrive when an asset is being used, because when an asset is being used, we expect its capacity to fall. Something like that. So what is depreciation? Why do we depreciate now? Most people misconceive, they have a total misconception about depreciation. Depreciation is not charged just because an asset actually, as time goes on, just because an asset is just wearing down. The wearing down of an asset is accounted for by impairment laws. Depreciation is simply the systematic allocation of the depreciable amount of an asset over its useful life. What do I mean by this? What do I mean is just a systematic allocation? Listen to one thing. When you pay rent, it's just for 1 month. And when preparing the financial statements, you know, the income statement is usually for 1 year. So if the rent is for 1 month, or let's say it's a rent for 1 year, that's an expenditure. And that expenditure is wholly accounted for in one period. But by having a non-current asset can be used for more than one period, but still it's an expenditure. So let's say you have consumed $4,000 on an asset, and that asset has a useful life of 4 years, let's say. It's not allowed, that asset is capitalized. You cannot go and expense it in the income statement, but rather you take it to the financial statements, to the statement of financial position, and put it there as a non-current asset. So what do we record is an expenditure in the income statement during this year, during the first year? Ever since you incurred a cost of $4,000 over 4 years, if you take $4,000 over four, you obtain $1,000. So you could say that it's like treating an expense of $1,000 to the income statement each year. So instead, that means that the asset which you capitalize to the statement of financial position as $4,000 can be taken to the income statement in four installments, $1,000 each year, and pass it to the income statement before realizing it. So something like that. And right here now, let's go to depreciable amount. You have to listen very careful to this explanation, because actually they give you the true sense. They give you the true sense of what we are just going to do in the job. So what's the depreciable amount? Simply speaking of the depreciable amount, let's say you have an asset, and your asset maybe, let's say you bought it for, you bought your asset at a cost of, let's say, how much? Let's say you bought it at $4,000. And let's say your asset will stay for 5 years. Let's just presume this, 5 years. And let's say at the end of 5 years, the asset will have the residual value of, let's say $500. Let's say you could sell it at $500. So what is the depreciable amount? We all see and know that $4,000 is the cost, but at the end of 5 years, the asset will be worth only $500. And that means that what amount will have been consumed? 4,000 minus 500. So the depreciable amount, the DA, equals to $4,000 minus 500, which equals to 3,500. This is the depreciable amount that I was speaking about. So after knowing something like this, you learn a lot and find that, oh, so this is a depreciable amount, no problem. So this is the point of learning a lot of concepts before going further into other standards. A16 is the mother of standards. So you have to be very, very conversant with it. So I think we're about to finish. We don't have much long time. Let's just go for a few minutes, and then we'll rest, we'll proceed tomorrow. Now let's go to recognition. Before anything, let me tell you one thing. There is something called the conceptual framework. We'll also go through it. But for any standard, you have to understand this thing. You have to know when to recognize. This is recognition. There is something called measurement. There is something called presentation. Presentation. And then you have something called disclosure. Something like this. So ultimately, we encounter these things. So at each standard that you will be going through, you have to go through those things. There is something called the conceptual framework, and I think we have to go through it. It's very, very useful. So now let's go to recognition. What is recognition? Recognition simply means incorporating an item in the business's accounts. In this case, not that we are not speaking of PPE, so these are assets. So assets actually recognize the statement of financial position. But when speaking of recognition, it simply means incorporating an item, actually in the statement of profit or loss. That could be a statement of financial position. That's the meaning of recognizing it. That's the meaning of recognition. You have to understand these matters. If you recognize something, that means you have disclosed it. Disclosing means making it open. So if you recognize it, you have disclosed it. So disclosure, just by recognizing it, it's a disclosure. But also just by putting something in the notes to the financial statements, that too is a disclosure. You have to understand that. So recognition. So by recognizing something, that means you got the financial statements. You say, this line here means a PPE. How can you be so courageous to go to the financial statement, take a line there and write this is the PPE? That only goes to show that you have to be sure that it is an asset. And if it is an asset, that means you expect resources from that asset. But not that one, not just that one. You expect resources, that means that's why you see it as an asset. But also, what if you cannot measure that asset? You have an asset, you know that it will give you economic benefits, but actually you do not know its value. If you don't know its value, that means you cannot write its figure. And if you cannot write its figure, that means you cannot recognize it. That's why there are two simple recognition criteria when dealing with actually a PPE, and not just PPE, most of assets will encounter the same recognition criteria. So, recognition of PPE depends on two criteria. First, it is probable that the future economic benefits associated with the asset will flow to the entity. The company must expect that future economic benefits will flow. That's the meaning of an asset. If it's an asset, but you cannot obtain any benefit, why would you recognize that asset? Would not expect. But B2, the cost of the asset to the entity can be measured reliably. If you are sure that you obtain the economic benefits, but you do not know actually the cost you have incurred to obtain that asset, that means you cannot write it. You cannot just presume, let me put $10,000, let me put $20,000, just because you are sure that the asset will give economic benefits. So that's another thing. But it's actually very obvious. And so we go here, we are told that these recognition criteria apply to subsequent expenditure as well as cost incurred initially. What does it mean by this? Let's say initially you incurred a cost of, let me put an illustration here. Let's say initially I built a house for, how much? I built a house for $10,000 like this, and then five months later, I extended the building. I put an extension to a building. That extension to a building, let's say, added $2,000, something like this. That means I initially had $10,000 and then $2,000. So the criteria used to recognize this $10,000 will also be used to recognize this $2,000. And thus you'll end up with $12,000. 10 here, 2. So you have a total of 12, something like that. So you have to be aware of this thing. But also here, let's go to separate items. Let's go to separate items, and after here we can end up here. For today, it's not bad. We have done well, actually. How do you deal with separate items? Now you're told here, most of the time, assets will be identified individually, but this will not be the case for smaller items. You'll find a small item like tools. which are sometimes classified as inventory and written off as an expense. So actually, you can have items that are, if the items are of very small value, they can sometimes just be written off as an expense instead of an asset. But also, you are told here you can have major components or spare parts. However, should recognize this property, plant, and equipment. If something is of a considerable amount of a considerable value, you cannot just write it off as an expense. So you also have to consider it. So how do you do about, how do you deal with that? So you were told that for very large and specialized items, an apparently single asset should be broken down into its composite parts. And this occurs when the different parts have different useful lives and different depreciation rates are applied to each part. For example, an aircraft. This is something very, very useful. You have an aircraft and the body and the engines are separated and they have different useful lives. Let me give you this illustration. This is a very, very important point. Presume you have encountered a question. You have an aeroplane. An aeroplane actually has a total cost of, let's just presume, it's just a presumption, let's say $20 million. But this aeroplane has two component parts. It has a body. It has a body, and the body actually costs, let's say $16 million, but also it has an engine. The engine costs $4 million. So if you have something like this, the body 16 and the engine 4, you are given further information that this body of yours has actually a useful life of, let's just presume that the body can stay for, suppose, 5 years. The body can stay for 5 years, while let's say the engine can stay for 8 years. Let's just presume this. So if you are told something like this, and since they have different depreciation rates, they have different useful lives, you'll have to depreciate this 16 million separately. And also you have to depreciate these 4 million separately. And then you will sum their depreciation to obtain the depreciation for the aeroplane. So you just deal with each item separately, just like that. That's how we go about this situation. So just have to be very, very conversant about what I'm speaking about. Actually, we'll see a lot when dealing with questions. So as I told you, this is the next section. The next section is about measurement. But actually, you'll see it in the next section. So just go through measurement here. After going through measurement, I think you'll be ready. You will be ready to come to the questions. There are example practice questions here. You'll look at these practice questions and explain each and everything on these. But it's better that we start with the explanations. Then we go to the questions one by one, and actually, we'll ultimately reach to where. We just want. So if you have not subscribed, you can subscribe to this channel to just support us, but also to receive regular updates on what is to come next. Thank you very much.